Todd, we're here to talk a little bit about wheat midge and managing of wheat midge. Tell us a little bit about the 2012 growing season. Did we see an increased level or area that wheat midge was in?
I wouldn't say we saw increased levels, but we've certainly seen some pockets in areas where damage occurs. And one of the challenges is not necessarily knowing where they're going to pop up from one year to the next. And that's what makes having a tolerant product like midge tolerant wheat such a proactive and positive approach to managing the pest.
Right, so now there we have had a couple reports about the area of wheat midge being reported has expanded slightly. So it's certainly it's not necessarily an economic threshold, but it's an early warning that this pest can and does travel quite a bit. Tell us a little bit about how using a tolerant variety would work into the management scheme.
Well, by incorporating a tolerant variety into your management scheme, you've got the built-in protection. And so whether the midge are there or not, you've already taken that proactive step. The nice part about the technology is that there's no penalty, really, for using the varieties. They're strong agronomically. And so when you launch a new technology, there's always the fear that it's going to take a step back and you're giving up something to get the new technology. And that's not the case with midge-tolerant wheat. If you look in the provincial guides, in each of the three prairie provinces, the midge-tolerant wheat are among the top yielders in all categories.
Now, these are varietal blends, so they're marked with a VB to mark them that. Tell us a little bit about what's a varietal blend.
So you have to step back a little bit to understand the technology. And the varieties, the tolerant varieties, have incorporated an SM1 gene. And so it's a naturally occurring trait, but it's very effective at deterring midge feeding. The midge, as soon as they bite into the kernel, they're turned off and look elsewhere. And they're not very mobile insects, so they end up starving to death, essentially. So to prevent the rapid buildup of tolerance of virulent midge, because it'll be a very low level that will actually still be able to feed, and if you were able to select for them, the population would rapidly grow, and you'd end up losing your tolerance. So what breeders have done is add in 10% of a susceptible variety, which is the refuge. And that allows the population to stay in balance and ensure that the technology will remain viable for, the model shows up to 90 years as opposed to being less than 10 if we were to allow the varieties to be grown without the refuge.
All right, and that's an important point, that the midge is still going to feed. So the midge will feed on the tolerant varieties, on the susceptible varieties. So farmers who have planted a blend may still see some midge feeding. Is that correct?
Absolutely. The insect has to take a nibble of the kernel to be deterred from feeding. So you will see some low-level damage. And under extreme pressures, you might see even elevated damage. But the important part is those kernels will not be thrown out the back end of the combine. They'll remain as part of the yield. And that's where you see the maintenance of the yield with these products. In other cases where you're maybe using susceptible varieties, the kernels will maybe largely consumed and blown out the back end of the combine and not be present at all. So producers can, that's why we use the term tolerant and not resistant, so that you will expect some low-level feeding and some damage. That and the fact that 10% of the sample, 10% of the blend is susceptible, and so there'll be some feeding damage there as well. But by and large, the damage will be less, and yields are typically higher.
And it's a quality concern as well, right? So you should see. Do you see that difference with maintaining a quality?
In terms of maintaining the samples, we've seen in areas where there's extreme feeding pressure, yes, you do see the difference. We've had many comments from growers over the last several years that have shown that they've been able to maintain grade and enhance yield by using tolerant varieties.
Under extreme pressure, would farmers still spray? If they're going to use the tolerant varieties, should they just assume not to spray and just keep watch, or what's the recommendation?
Oh, it's that's a tough one. If there were some extreme cases or reasons to want top quality, then you may still consider spraying. But for the most part, the trait is quite effective, and it's probably best to let it do its job. Because if you end up spraying, you kind of defeat the purpose of the technology in the first place, because you're killing the beneficial insects that will help provide control further down the line. So that's one of the real strong suits of the technology, is you're allowing beneficial predatory insects to control some of the midge as well and keep things in balance rather than having to rely on chemical controls.
Anything else? What do we miss?
I think the only other piece to one of the things we need to do and often remind growers is the importance of stewardship with the technology. And the every sale of midge-tolerant wheat requires a stewardship agreement to be signed. And what that agreement says is that the grower will not farm save the seed beyond one generation past certified. That ensures that the refuge stays in balance and the technology is there for many generations of future farmers, not just a few years.
Okay.